Hello, everybody. It's so nice to see you, and welcome to the guests who are watching this webinar. My name is Hayley Bryant. I'm the team leader for a project in Mozambique where FHI 360 is now a sub-partner to two new local primes who were once FHI 360 partners. We had the task of building their capacity to become local primes, able to receive USAID funding. We did that and now we're a sub-partner to them. So I am living the theme of this workshop, and I'm very happy to welcome and present to you three executive directors who are also living this theme. There's three fantastic, inspiring organizations that I'd had the pleasure to talk with, and they also have all worked as subs to international organizations, and they are now the prime partners with direct USAID funding. Many of them have funding from other donors as well, and those same internationals are now sub-partners, so it fits perfectly with the theme of shifting the power. And we are so pleased to have this opportunity for these executive directors and these inspiring women to share with the international development professionals in the audience, their experiences and their tips and suggestions. So first, I'm gonna introduce each of you. And as I say your name, please give a wave. Nui Nguyen Xin is the executive director of PGTIM, a Myanmar organization that started as a women's group in 1997 and is now managing community health services for HIV and TB across the country for tens of thousands of patients.
Hello, nice to see you all. And I'm very happy to be part of this webinar.
Great, we're so happy to have you here. Gertrude Shumba is the executive director of the Family AIDS Caring Trust, or FACT for short. And this is a Zimbabwean organization that was created by a pediatrician in 1987 to mobilize support for HIV positive children. And she's coming to you from Zimbabwe.
And good morning, good afternoon, everyone. It's really a pleasure to be in this webinar. We feel so much honored. Thank you.
We are the ones that are honored that you guys are so busy and are taking the time to do this. And Malica is here in Maputo with me. Malica de Melo, is the executive director of the International Center for Reproductive Health, Mozambique. This is a Mozambican organization established in 2009. And its mission is to produce knowledge and advocate and provide services for improving reproductive and sexual health and rights of vulnerable people in Mozambique. Malica.
Thank you so much. Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. Thank you so much for inviting us, and I'm very excited and very happy to be invited to this meeting.
Thank you again, all of you, taking the time. You are incredibly busy people working miracles in your own countries, but I love having this international group. So I'm going to get right into it because we only have about 30 minutes. Gertrude, let's start with you. You've shared with me that FACT started with a budget of about $50,000, and now you manage $15 million a year with 250 professional staff. You're the prime on at least two USAID-funded awards, in addition to multiple other projects funded by UN agencies and others. And particular to this conversation, FACT, with an F, now manages PACT, with a P, an international NGO, as a sub on some of your OBC work. I'm going to ask you two questions. Can you take us back to when you first became a prime partner? I understand it was a lengthy process to get there. What made you nervous or excited about becoming the prime? And then the second question is, what made you decide to bring on an international partner as a sub?
Thank you very much. Indeed, I'm Gertrude Shumba, the executive director for FACT. I've been with this organization for the past 8 years. And that's when we also became a prime recipient to USAID. when we started off, we went through lots of rigorous processes where we had to work on our policies. We went through lots of capacity building on how to respond to USAID funding with the support of World Education and also JSI International, especially on governance issues. That's where they were very strong on JSI supporting us on governance, making sure that we have the correct skill set of our board members who could also give the oversight of the organization. And also, we had lots of capacity building around the roles and responsibilities of both the executive and also respective key personnel, coming up with job descriptions, which you find they were a bit sketchy before. So it was not an easy process. It took us about 2 years to then graduate, become a prime recipient of USAID. Indeed, it was quite exciting as we could now see the benefits of implementing, working directly with USAID, getting funding straight, and also working with our sub-grantees. It was quite an exciting moment for us.
Great. You mentioned when we talked some HR challenges that you faced.
Yes, indeed. We had some HR challenges when we finally graduated, because we had to go through the NOPAS process. So when they did the capacity, the assessment, there was a realization that our key personnel that had gone through all the capacity building process did not meet the requirements of USAID. So we could not take them as key personnel. So it was quite a shocker to us, because we thought these are the people who had built the organization then to be eligible for, to be a prime, but all of a sudden we had to drop them. So we had to re-advertise so that we could get the correct skill set that was required by USAID. So to us, it was quite a big surprise to us. But anyway, we really understood in the end, because now there was an increase in funding. Initially, when we were just a sub-recipient of World Education, it was about 900,000. Now we were supposed to manage a 10 million grant. So We then understood that there was need really to have people with the necessary skills and experience to manage such a huge grant.
That's a challenge I'm hearing about from many other organizations as well. Here's Mozambique and in other countries. The people that built the organization are not the ones that are now leading the implementation. So it's an interesting puzzle and something we should all be thinking about.
Sure.
Malica, I'm going to go to you, and then maybe I'll come back again to Gertrude. Your organization is now the prime, managing $34 million and 12 other local sub-partners. But let's talk about your international sub-partner, because you chose FHI 360. And when deciding, I understand you had multiple other INGOs that were interested in working with you. So when you were making your decision, what characteristics, aside from technical expertise, were important for your relationship with the international sub-partner?
Yes. So thank you for the question, Hayley. I think that for us, the most important decision main factor was the relationship that we had at the time with that we built in 2017 with FHI in the past. So it was like for us a trust relationship that we developed along the way. So when we knew that the bid was coming out, we knew that we wanted to run as a prime, but we wanted also to approach FHI 360 for being part of our consortium. But we were afraid that FHI would also run as a prime. But then we started this conversation, and the bid was for the local organization. And then we just could get this perfect, like a very good a marriage with a FHI. And then at the time we were approached by several NGOs, but as I say, we built this in 2017 because we had to drop the we had to end the PASUS consortium for keep population due to the Mexico City policy. And the way that FHI 360 at the time handled it, it was very respectful and very kind to us. So this, we started to build this sort of trust. And when this policy was lifted, FHI came back to us. And yeah, we developed this very strong relationship, and that it was a very important decision factor to us to run with FHI and not others organizations. So yeah, and we'll still appreciate this open communication, and we have challenges, but we still have this trust in openness with FHI.
That's great. I'm glad to hear that. So openness and trust is key. Gertrude, I'd like to come back to you because you had shared in our call a little bit about why you chose PACT as a partner. Could you take just a minute to tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, indeed. For us, the reason why we chose PACT was because of their extensive experience in OVC programming. And prior to the call, we had a relationship about 15 years back, where they did some capacity building to fact where we just a CBO. But then of course now, because of this call, realizing their capacity around OVC and also on climate change, because it was also key. We had positioned ourselves that we're going to focus more on climate resilience or climate change. And also there was a component of capacity building of our sub-recipients, was we have about three local sub-recipients. So they had that extensive experience and we felt we were going to go for them. And I like the fact that they were also proactive. They had they sent us their capability statement. They took the initiative. We had so many people who approached us, the international amount. But we finally zeroed down on PACT because of their extensive experience. Models that proven to be efficient by USAID. So we then settled for PACT. And even their ask on the budget, it was quite reasonable, considering the 25 million that we were supposed to bid for the OVC.
Yeah, you mentioned that it was cost was a factor as well as the global technical expertise. Thanks, Dad. And you guys both bring up good points. Very helpful points for everyone to pay attention to. Manuel has been very patiently waiting on the sidelines. I know she's ready to jump in, but I'm going to ask you a specific question. You shared with me that your organization, PG Khin, manages funding from the Global Fund and USAID. The USAID grant supports community engagement in tuberculosis. And FHI 360 is an international partner that's provided tuberculosis technical support and organizational support for PG Khin. The two organizations have worked together for 8 years. First with FHI 360 as the prime, and then it shifted 3 years ago. So you're a little further into this than some of us. Can you tell me about the first 3 years as a prime partner? What made you confident? What made you nervous?
It is not nervous, it's like a concern. Our concern on that, the call, apply as a prime, is we have been working in implementation, taking implementation rule for many years, more than 20 years. So this is the first time. So we have a lot of concern and managing sub-grant and also managing a USA grant as a prime, especially our challenges is FHI used to what was that as a prime. So now we are a leading organization and working with the FHI. It would begin our nervous and also challenges.
So, and it's the role is a totally changed. And so, what makes us confident to take this prime role, and because of we know each other and we trust each other, we value, as I said, we have a very good relationship, like a partnership approach working with FHI. So that makes us really make a confidence. And another confidence is DG Khin has a very strong experience working with the civil society for almost 25 years, and also especially capacity building. So let me highlight about the FHI, how they support and how they work with us. So FHI always respect DG Khin as a prime role and give a space to lead. So this is really important, and that allow us to understand our role and to identify and the area we need technical support from FHI. So for example, the area we need technical support from FHI in the year one and year two and year three is different. So it's it's different. So FHI allows us to lead the pro and the SPRI, and also give an opportunity to identify the area we need, and they support us. So this is the way we are working. The another thing is that FHI support mainly, as I mentioned too, one is a technical support in tuberculosis, and they are very strong technical organization. Another one is a organizational operational support as a prime. So we also have a local partner civil society in our consortium. So FHI posts us how to lead the program, how to with the technical aspect of TV, and also communicate with our sub-partner, how to lead our sub-partner. We used to work as an implementing organization, not leading organization. So our teams, the staff member, at the beginning of the project, they don't really know how to lead the partner. So they are like, they very used to work with the implementation.
And I think you mentioned milestones too, right? FHI support figuring out for milestones.
Setting the milestone is also challenging, because the funding is linked to the milestone. And then another challenge just is that when we started this USA project in 2020, because of COVID in 2001, and also military coup in 2021.
It's just a challenge.
Yeah, this we have been very busy, a very challenging situation in this kind of COVID and also political situation. So the mindset and milestone is really challenging for us. So FHI coach us and try to support at how to set at milestone, and then after that, during very difficult challenging times, and they support at how to negotiate with the USA, because of the sometimes it's delayed milestone because of country situation. So they provide a lot of support and to set at milestone, negotiate with the USA, how to revise. So. And then for another important thing I just want to highlight is that FHI encourage us to take the lead, especially our prime role with the local partner, how to manage and, for example, like a developing SOP for grant management and applying in the practices. So it is really important that encouraging local to local capacity building and creating condition for development of local prime leadership and it is a site in the practices. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks so much, Manwei. Some great, great wisdom, there. And your points on engaging the sub-partners and engaging you and PG Khin being able to take the lead are very relevant and very insightful for everybody. So all of you, we're coming to the last part here, and I'm going to ask each of you, what are your recommendations
for, and the audience is mostly international development organizations or companies that might be thinking about shifting into a sub-partner role to a local organization such as yourself. What can an INGO or an international organization do to help make this relationship smooth and successful?
Yeah, for us to manage our relationships with INGOs is, I think we just need to maintain that mutual understanding and working in good faith, and noting that, remember, they've been into the game for a very long time. So they appreciate better the USAID rules and regulations. And also something that we also note is, you know, these rules and regs, they're just like reading a Bible from Genesis to Revelations, maybe a deliberate effort of looking at the key ones that to always make the organization function. So if people can just act in good faith and not taking it like a small fish trying to help a big one, I think that's where at times we get it all wrong. But I think so far, looking at our experience with PACT, it's always working in good faith, the way we appreciate our capacities, and also being there for us whenever it's very necessary. Because you can see, like, we are capacity building our subs. So in our previous funding, there wasn't much focus on capacity building, but now it's there. So PACT has come in very handy in giving us various tools that we can use, like the Italka one for capacity building of our subs, which has actually gone a long way. Because remember, USAID Forward is there to support 70% of locals to receive funding. But it's not a walk in the path all the same to get there. It comes with lots of patience and also having dedicated staff. And, you know, being a local NGO, normally you don't have anyone who is dedicated to do the capacity building process. So you just need to see how best you can also have a diverse of funders, especially on unrestricted funds, who can only support you on your journey to maintain or become a prime recipient.
Thank you for those recommendations. Those are all, and I like the image of the small fish trying to manage a big fish and saying, look, we're all here for the same goal, same objectives. Let's work together. That's
and see, maybe also to notice, maybe you have to be very cautious when you're considering the budget. Because remember, INGOs would come in with fairly bigger budgets, because remember, they have to consider travel, see if they're out of the country. Most of them, they're in the States. So it could be a bit expensive, but if you've got a modest budget, it works perfectly well. So that is something that we noted as a lesson that we learned. But I think it's all about having a mutual relationship where people negotiate for the best for the two parties.
Okay, good point. It's a negotiation. Manuel, did you wanna add anything for your recommendations?
Yeah, I'd like to add a few points. And the first one is give opportunity to a local organization to lead and to, instead of making the localization agenda into tools. And I think it should take into account local leadership and initiative and initiate method and their strategy and the power to make decision in their affected community. So the second one is that partnership is important with mutual respect on both sides. So like I highlight the equal partnership. So when we talk about localization, and local leadership is need to take Khin into account imbalanced power in some subject of internationalized humanitarian assistance or internationalized funding. And it should move towards a real partnership with the equal partner approach. So sometimes it focuses on building capacity of the project and not the organization. So we want to support to build our organization so that we can continue beyond the project. So we know that what if we're talking about organizational development, we know that what we need, but some international NGOs are often saying that we should work in specific area. So let us lead and let us tell you what we need. So the final point is I also really ask to the international community, mutual accountability and taking risk sharing and greater transparency, like openness and other localization and local lead agenda with the equal partnership. So when I'm talking about the risk sharing, especially Myanmar case, we need to go beyond the fishery risk. And it is more than that. It is a safeguarding aspect of ethical risk and localization in Myanmar are confronting multiple risks at the same time. So accountability towards the affected population community must be ensured throughout the project. So finally, I just would like to highlight that mutual accountability is also important.
Very good points and consistent. Now, I know one of those points is one that Malika talked about as well, sort of respect, mutual respect and partnership. But Malika, but also picking up on what you said about strengthening the organization, that's something Malika mentioned as well. Malika, would you like to add to that and tell us any recommendations you have?
Yeah, thank you. And I would like to add to what Gertrude and also Nimzim said, because, and I agree fully about this first point that he mentioned. But also, I would like to add the capacity strengthening, especially on leadership also. And to give the sense of, in terms of like the global health vision, and because we are growing and we are implementing now as a prime, as USAID fund partner. So there is so much in the world. So we must to know what is the future will ask for us as organizations. So how should we be prepared for that? And I think this vision of the future and what is coming and to be prepared is a key for us at that moment. Another thing, it's about the building of the initiative and agency of our organization. So how to make this precise and very conscious decisions on what is the best for the organization, what is the best path to follow, because we are now growing, we have the fund, and our fund is for 5 years. But after 5 years, how should we get to the 6th year? And this is very interesting about what Nimzim said. It's not about the equal partnership, because it's about we are now in the project, but our organization is more than the project. So the organization should also grow and not only the project. So this, it's important not to have this so vertical vision, but like horizontal vision of the whole organization has to grow. And I think that at last, about the leadership, it's important to have this conscious of what is leadership, what is ethics, what is the moral values, and how does leadership and manager at the senior management team, they should have, and they should be aligned with the organizations and also with the donors, because this should be very, very aligned. And I think at the final is the networking, because it's important to establish a very good networking. Thank you.
And this is part of an international network that's forming.
Yeah.
One thing that's been fascinating about talking with organizations all over the world is just hearing how context can be so different, yet some of the challenges are so similar. You know, what you
Sue, of you have talked about the challenge with human resources, having these people that built the organization, but now needing to bring in different staff with a different level of professional skills. Several of you have talked about the importance of organizational support and capacity strengthening for subs. And you've all talked about the importance of relationship and trust and loyalty. And I think that's a really important message for everyone to hear, is that these relationships are built over time. And we have a little bit of taste of what people are looking for. And now each of you is also looking to the future. And I would like everyone to really pay attention to these organizations, because I was very impressed. And I know in the information for this webinar, they're going to have the names of the organizations, and I'm hoping an email contact and a website as well. FACT, Family Age Children Trust, PG Khin, and ICRH Mozambique are all organizations to pay attention to. And I really want to thank you all for sharing your insights. Again, we've learned a lot about how we can effectively shift the power dynamics. It's a journey that's going to be ongoing. We're all learning as we do it. But you guys, Gertrude, Manwe, and Malica, are at the forefront of setting a new path of development. And it's so wonderful that you're willing to put that knowledge out there and share that. So that all together we can work towards making this journey a success. And I look forward to continuing to learn with you, and hope we'll have more opportunities to talk.